So today we are going to understand what is our complete framework with a simple example. We have seen pieces of our framework, what is the need of the algorithm analysis, and how do you do algorithm analysis now, what is the notation we are going to use it up, and all these phases, some of the phases of what you call our framework, we really understood. But we take a concrete example to go through the complete walk through our framework here to get the feel of what do you mean by the problem solving in reality. So as usual, we start with one of the problems here. Let me do the problem statement here. So given an array consisting of n integers, so in which each element is between 1 to n minus 1, find an efficient algorithm that returns any duplicate integer exist in the array. Let's understand the meaning of the problem statement. I just go read the problem one more time. Given an array consisting of n integers, in which each element is between 1 to n minus 1, find an efficient algorithm that returns any duplicate integer exist in the array. Let's take some input to really get the meaning of the problem here. Let me give some input here. Let's say n equal to 5. So our range will be definitely element range 1 to 5 minus 1, 1 to 4. Let's take a simple example. Your 5 element array. So first element could be 4, next element could be 2, next element could be 3, next element could be 1. Now that's only possibilities. One of them must repeat. Here let's say 2 might be there. The expected answer here is output is 2. So in this case, it's only one duplicate. Let's take one more example. This time, I take n equal to 6. A range is 1 to 5. Let me pick 6 elements. 3, 4, 5, 6. Now, there is a 5. There is a 4. Let's say 2. Again 5. Again 3 here. 2. 3 plus 3, 6. So you can see in this array here, we're satisfying our requirement. Each element is between 1 to n minus 1 range. 1 to 5, each element is 1 to 5, but repetition you can see, 4 is repeated, 2 is repeated, all I'm asking here is any one duplicate. In this case, you can return output either 2 you can return up or you can return up 5, any of them is fine. So that's what the problem is asking us to solve. So here, the element range is 1 to n minus 1. You got to find up an efficient algorithm that returns any duplicate integer. So if you have multiple duplicates more than 2, any one of them is fine. So how do we really attack this problem? So if you recall our framework, so always we start with the problem. So then get deeper into the problem, understand the problem. Then in the second phase, we got to think of solutions now. So by looking at this problem, what is that first working thought which we get into our mind here? Let's bring up the patterns in our memory here, whatever you have it up, to get a working solution here. If nothing is there, let's start look at the problem, understand the problem more deeper, at least one working solution, always you can bring it up. The way I'm returning up 2 or in this case 2 or 5, so surely our mind is doing up some kind of a process to really giving up this answer. Let's get out of that idea and see, so how do you really make it as what they call more systematic in nature? Sure. So let me write that as solution number one. Solution number one. So let me rewrite the data to understand how do you really get the answer. Sure. 4, 2, 3, 1, 2. So our n is equal to 5 in this case here. The range is definitely 1 to 4. Now, how do I really got an answer to him? If you just look at this clearly, one simple way of finding up 2 is repeated is, I can start with 4. I'm checking up, 4 is available in the next slot. I'm looking at all the elements which are coming after 4. It's not matching, not matching. So 4 is not repeated, hence not a duplicate. Now I'll take 2. I don't want to look back because this comparison already done. So look forward. So no match, no match. But here we got a match. Once you got a match, return 2 as a duplicate. That means one simplest systematic process, you can build it out. Here is take each element, compare all the elements which are coming after that. If there is a match, we got a repetition and that hence duplicate. If not, continue with the next element. So this is the idea which we can able to give up guaranteed working solution. Let's take much more what they call a bigger size example here. Let's say, so 4, 6 here. Now let me give 7. Next is 8. Maybe my array size I'm giving is n to 9, n equal 9. Range is 1 to 8. Now 3, then is 2. So then I'll give it as 1. Total 3 plus 3, 6, 7. There is one more. So 5 we are going to give it up. So still array, one more element I need to give. One of them must repeat. So let's say 4 is repeat or 5 is repeated. So the problem statement, if you understand carefully, definitely there will be at least one duplicate here. Since size is 9, range is 1 lesser here, one element, one of them must repeat here. So there's no such case where we don't have a duplicate for this specific problem. Now you can see here, if you apply our strategy, take 1. So all the elements which comes after 1, keep comparing, no match, no match, no match, no match. Then take 4, compare here, continue this. Then no match, 6 and 7, 8. Maybe in this case, the last but one element 5, when I compare forward here, we got a match. That's where I'm returning 5 as a duplicate. So this could act like a worst case. So to really understand how good this algorithm is really doing it up, we know from previous sessions that, so we are going for worst case analysis here. Maybe if one would have been immediately available somewhere here, so that would have been a best case for that. But the benchmarking are always, we take what is the right way to really understand complete algorithm performance is its worst case performance. That gives a guaranteed performance, we can say. That's why, so this algorithm, if you want to really get feel of how good it is behaving it up, what input this algorithm really behaves worst way, this guaranteed performance we are able to get it out. So now here in this case, we are really doing up all, only when you come last but one element here, we got an answer here. This is the worst case scenario. Let's try to label this idea and also try to analyze this algorithm to really get a clarity how good is really, is behaving it up. So solution one, since it's like a naive strategy, we really call this as naive or a brute force. But how do you analyze our dimensions now? We saw from previous sessions now, there are two dimensions or matrix we should analyze for every algorithm. So one is time dimension, other is space dimension. They are the two matrix. So for every algorithm, theoretically, we always analyze. Before writing a code, we try to do that to filter out so non-useful solutions, and we pick a few of them after filtering it up before going for actual coding and evaluation. So here, what is the time complexity of this algorithm? What is the space complexity of this algorithm? We want to understand. Again, if we recall, what is the meaning of time complexity? We want to analyze theoretically without dependent on any hardware, operating system, or language. We know that time is always the number of low-level operations. Here in this logic, what is that low-level operation we are doing up? If you look at, so first we are taking this element, we are comparing. Then we take this element, we compare. This guy keep on comparing. The core operation here is a comparison, which is surely a low-level operation for any kind of processor. How many comparisons, maximum, worst case we are going to do it up, is going to be guaranteed performance. That's why our time complexity, which is system independent, what they call analysis, is really giving up. So now we want to really analyze that. That's where we'll try to analyze how many. First guy, I may require almost all n minus 1 comparison in the worst case. Second guy, n minus 2 comparisons. Third guy, n minus 3 comparisons, and so on. Last but one, we need one comparison. This is surely a maximum here. That's where we write it as maximum here. So how do you really, get an expression for this? N minus 1 multiplied by N by 2. So which is nothing but less than or equal to N square minus N by 2. We know from our notation, this is nothing but big of N square. Even more tighter bond, we can write theta. So you refer to other videos we discussed, the symbols now, you get a clarity on why I use theta here. This is the time complexity of the first algorithm. What is the space complexity required for this algorithm here? Again, to recall, space means now we are not interested about how many exact number of bytes, because each hardware, a word size is different. That's why space, when you say it up, how many number of words extra this algorithm require to get this logic, implementable here. So that's where space, if you look at here, first element will take it up. We got to compare, maybe one index variable can help us to move on through the remaining part of the array. So the same thing carries for every element. So few variables, constant number of variables are enough here. We write that as C units now. Let me rewrite here. Space complexity is C units. Again, this we analyze, when you really write into notation, it is big of 1. That's why in summary, our algorithm 1, solution 1, so we'll take time complexity as theta of n square, space as constant here. So is it a good algorithm for production grade systems here? When n is going bigger and bigger here, the scale of this algorithm, how would it is? So theoretically we got n square, but let's experience the coding of this to see what do you call the scale of the n square algorithms here. Let's move on to the coding. Now we got this n square algorithm here. So theoretically we got it of n square, but in practice, how does this n square really fare it out? How do we know? Let's implement this and let's experience how n square algorithms really perform in reality. So I'm using CPP now. So go to new, let's create a CPP project. CPP managed build. So I call this as find duplicate. I take a empty project or hello world with specific compiler in my system. Let me maximize it. So this is what we have it up. Now let's start writing up solution. Let's write a convert the algorithm 1 to the code. So what is the input anyway here? Is output is find duplicate 1. The input is going to be our in array. And size of that must be passed here. So this is what we have it up. Now we got input array which is having a bunch of integers now. N is the number of elements now. You got written duplicate which is available in this array. Let's convert the strategy 1, the thought process, into the code. So what is the thought process now? We take any element, we start from the first element here. We compare with all elements coming after. So if there's no match, then we move on to the next element. Again, we compare to the all forward elements. So when you translate into code, this is how it look like here. For int I equal to 0, we start with the 0th index, I less than, we carry on till end of it, plus plus I. But for each element, we are taking the position, whatever position we are taking up, from that element, the next position for that is what matters now. That's why my j index always starts from I plus 1, j less than, so j less than n here, plus plus j. So what do? So we compare in of ith element equal to in of j, if that is, if both are match, then we return that duplicate in of I. So if nowhere this match available, which cannot happen in this case, we return some special value. Let me import hash include. So c limits. We return this special value int underscore min. So that's what solution number 1. Let's see the correctness of this algorithm and also scale of this algorithm here. Now to do that, let me first take input anyway. So integer n, cn, what is the size you want to pass it? Let's create an array here of size n here. So once we got an array, Now we write a test case 1 to fill this array with our worst case input. So I pass in here and also n. Let's get fill up. Once you get fill it up, now let's invoke the algorithm find duplicate 1, the corresponding program. Find duplicate 1 in and n you pass it, and we just display the result animation. See out. Find duplicate 1. Now, so we really display cout. Now, after displaying this, then we want to measure this. We want to clock this time also. Let me give the time measurement animation. So here, so let me use a header file hash include c time. Let me bring it up time underscore t. Create two variables, start as well as end variables. Let's take, so start of, so time of, the method name is time of, pass start, get the value into start. After the method, then again we take it up time of the second one, which is going to be end. So once we got start n times, now here, now we try to display the difference anyway. See out the time taken colon plus how much difference. Now let me take a so diff time here. So let's take up diff time of end and also start comma end. Now it is usually comes up in a floating. Let me do casting here to string of, then new line for a clean output. Let me fill up this test case 1. So void test case 1, my array is passed up and also my n. So here we really get the exact data. That is, so pass end also as a reference. So let's fill up test case 1. What is the worst case input? So we fill up from 1 to n minus 1. Last element we repeat n minus 1. So we got to check almost every element till the end. That's why. So I'm going to fill up for integer I starts from 0, I less than, except last element. So I want to fill it up everything here. So I just take in of I is equivalent to I plus 1. Then my last element in of n minus 1 index I fill with n minus 1. And also I want to display this to see. So how is what values are filled up here? So just take a loop. Integer I starts from 0, I less than n plus I c out. I will display in of I, just to give a little space here, end of this. Now we give c out end l here. Let's run this. Let's build this project anyway. Here. Go to project, we call it as build. You can see build success anyway. Here. Let's run this, run as local CCP application. Let me pass 10 values here. You can see 1 to 9. 9 is the result. Let me give you one more end L here. C out. Now let me rerun this as run as CPP application local. Now 10 elements. You can see this is my, this is how the, test case, you're actually filling it up. The result is 9. Time is nothing. Now let me test for little bigger size here. Now 100 elements I'm giving up, output is 99. So the solution is working. Boundary cases, you try to test it out. Now what I want to do here is I want to test this for scale. So this display will become painful when I go for large values of n. Let me just give block comment over here. The display, I'm just giving a comment. Now let me go for run as. Let me rebuild it, project, rebuild it. So success. So run as local CCPU application. Let me give you 100, 1000, 10,000, 1 lakh. Let's see. For 1 lakh, how much time this solution one takes? You can clearly see there's a visible, you know, lapse. So for 1 lakh only this much pain. So you can see almost minus 13. The reason is the gap end start will give it up. So end comma start. Let me rebuild this project. Let me run this. 100, 1000, 10,000, 1 lakh. You can see the visible lapse in a patient. So this is not acceptable issue. For 1 lakh this much time you're taking up. Imagine if I give 1 million, 10 million, 100 million and 1 billion. So we cannot imagine this to be production grade system, production grade solution. That's why Svensko algorithms in practice, when n is going bigger and bigger here, they really, really, takes huge amount of time, which is not accepted. Only one method we are talking about it. Imagine a product, when a request comes up, it has to invoke a chain of methods. All this pain cannot really, satisfy our response times now. That's why we want to look for better algorithms now. Let's discuss how can you really get a better algorithms in N square. If we can able to discover it up, we'll also experience those ideas.